Anybody has a cap, perhaps? Well, I have the good fortune yesterday of listening to the Dalai Lama, and he was wearing a cap like this, and with a visor, and you know, I had a laugh, but he was right.
Beszélni, vagy fogok beszélni egy kevesen, arról, hogy azokról az adatokról, amik...
What's the topic of my presentation? How do we raise information out of data? And how can we use our own tools to extract as much information as possible without having to pay a lot? And let me quickly reveal that the Syslog runtime log analyzer application is what I'm going to talk about. But due to the shortage of time, Syslog NG insider information won't be abandoned. And still, I would just touch upon this by the end of the presentation. I hope you will all begin pondering starting your homemade Syslog analysis project. But obviously, you will stay here for the night, and on Monday, you will start the day with that. And lots of people collect logs, but this is only about collecting them, accumulating them, and archiving them. And you tell people that you have the logs with lots and lots of information, but since you have that heap of information at your disposal, it would make sense to try to extract valuable information out of it, relying on the raw messages that come in. And this is going to benefit us because it's not just a one-off occasion filing the logs away, but you will actually get to know more about events, and I'll give you some tips and hints for queries you can start that any simple system administrator can do. And mind you, I'm a simple system administrator myself. What's the analysis process all about? Certainly, we need to gather the messages and then collect information about who's logging what and where. It seems simple, but it varies with the application. And there's lots of different kinds of logs lying about in all kinds of places. So you need to define standard conversion formats, because you want a single format to analyze the information, which we call normalization, using a fancy word. And there's two other things that are important about conversion protocol. Syslog is the protocol here. And I'm not going to get inside the details. Warn me if I do. And also, the format is important, because we need a single format, otherwise we won't be able to make sense of that. You know, I heard a database expert once claim that if you have junk in, you're going to have junk out. So you need to be able to make sense of it all, get valuable information, and squelch the noise. If you check your own logs and server logs, you will find lots of clutter inside. I'll show you examples. So then we'll do the analysis, and it will be important that you respond and react. What are the typical pitfalls? First of all, discovering where the logs lie about. Syslog, for instance, has many ways of collecting logs, dev logs, and reading files, and pipes and streams can all be read, which is important because, speaking about a Unix-based system, there's a syslog, and syslog is a good way of keeping log information about the system. And most of Linux users have not heard or not using these, so they would rather use a database or use a network connection or some other solution. And the orange highlight is no message, and that's the key problem. And I think both during yesterday and today there'll be a lot of talking about web-based and, you know, stevie wonder.com sort of website and block content logging issues. And also sundry formats represent a problem as well. Makeshift solutions, well, we have devised our own, and I will show you how it works and how to use it. But that's a problem. And also there are character set mismatches, and these are by and large manageable, but there's also clutter concerns, and that also can be managed. Log entries, messages, sometimes irrelevant. And also using a networked computer due to the internet economy, there's all kinds of log entries that you would know about anyway. So for instance, DNS is such that it's normal that every 5 minutes all kinds of weird zones are transferred. It's not even on our own server, it's on the VM server. It's a policy violation. And there's nothing we can do about these. We'd better screen them out, though, because they would just clutter our analysis and potentially distort our conclusions. I'll come back to this. And then a normalization. You get raw messages, and you should promulgate them into a common format that can be analyzed, such as timestamps, should be converted to the same format, because you have lots of syslog protocols and timestamp formats vary with each. You probably recall last year's presentation, or you may not, because I don't actually myself. And RFC 65, for instance, has a boot-up timestamp, which is not regular because it doesn't have the time zones or fractions of time. And 5424 is already using the ISO timestamp, so it'd be nice to convert them to a common format. And the other thing is using the same data format, because we have 35 applications using 75 different log formats, and unless we convert them all to a single log format, then we will not be able to make any sense of what's in there. And currently the biggest challenge is trying to use a single data format for user IDs and the rest of the data, because that's something that's really hard to address. Now, let's see the format of incoming messages and the key features. There are two parts for most messages: static content, which is the white part, and variable content, highlighted in orange. In an SSH log, accepted is a variable that varies. It can have two kinds of values. And the password at the moment will depend on the method, for instance, to authenticate the user. And four is a static part, and Peter is my user ID, and then a static part, and the IP address, the port, source port, SSH2, and this is the SSH protocol ID. And it can be either one or two. And those of you who have one should change to two. And if you see anything else, you're deep in trouble. And then the next one is an FTP daemon entry. Now you have the ID, the username, and now you are logged in. I'm giving you this example because this one is quite easy to bring to a common basis. And the next one is POP3, a Dovecat, an incoming message entry here. We're looking at the same thing. And RIP is the remote ID, LIP, local ID. So this is already merged, and we have a user ID. The IP address is important in this example, and the user ID as well. In the first two cases, for instance, as you can see, the user ID is not between brackets, and in the third case, it is, which is going to be a disturbance during our work. Now, let's check out SysLogNG. About 2 years ago, we incorporated a runtime log analysis feature, and that's log Panten DB. If you've heard of SysLogNG, there's an option there, or it rather is compulsory. Log paths and log routines have to be defined, and we have a new feature in the log path parcel and rewrite modules can be incorporated. This Panther module can use two different methods to interpret incoming entries, and when we're in luck, I could give you examples of two or three applications with strictly structured messages. Squid's access log, Apache's access log are two such examples, and Pure FTP, which I showed you a minute ago, it's one of these. But the problem is many people use other than any of these three daemons. They can have up to 15,000 different applications, and we can parse them into columns, and then using CSV, we can parse all them up, carve them up to entry parts. But life is not like that. We're generating all kinds of log entries, messages. If you are developers, I'd like to ask you ahead of time, please generate normal format log entries to make life easier. And this parser will be incorporated in the log path, and it will make sense of the log entry. CSV parser will say that this is CSV, and then we will parse the messages, and Pac10DB is the other parser, or DB parser is the other name, and that's Radix V pattern matching, which it does for us. And the benefit is that these two parsers are going to output recognized values into our own macros, and using those macros we can restructure the messages, or we can separately store them. There's two options. First, we can use a template or a rewrite to store them, or you just open up a database and the macro contained information could all be stored in a field of the table and retrieve, and you can use it later on. It's working runtime, and it's a hell of a fast process. And as for incoming messages, we can classify them into all kinds of categories we come up with, such as violation, error, noise, system. And then you can say that each message is part of a category or class, and then you'll be able to do filtering, and you can search amongst the entries. And the other thing, which is not on here, but we can also use tags. We can tag them. All of you read blogs, and blogs have tags attached to them regarding content, and you can assign keywords. So our log entries can also be attached, tags and markers, so that we can mine the sensible information out of them at a later stage. Now let's see how this works. A radix tree is the algorithm we use, and this is a character-based decision tree. So you have a decision tree that's built up. It has one drawback. We can't move back along the tree, because in certain cases we may want to work our way backwards down the tree. Now let's see how the log messages can be further interpreted. Analysts also use reg expat. I wonder if you've written any. These are strings that are easy to get wrong, and a pattern DB is a good solution because these patterns can be put together very easily looking at the previous message formats. So what we want to do is rewrite the orange parts and accept the was not struck, but the authentication user and port information, these were all extracted using a parser. And in between the at signs, you can expect strings, IP addresses, or digits, numbers. And all we need to do is take the 3, 5, 10, up to 200,000 messages that come in every hour. So we will write the patterns to help analyze them, and then we'll try to apply these values. Now let's check out our parsers. We have a lot more, but some examples are included here. String parsers can be of these kinds. String, E string, and Q string, or any string, and separation characters can also be typified. Q string is a quotation character. In between the brackets, we have the information that I want to read. And there's also a wildcard, any string, which means all the characters till end of line, but you'd better not use it because it will just mask the information that's in there, because the looser your pattern, the more likely it will give you irrelevant information, because you can very nicely parse email addresses such as at sign, and you take the part before and the part after, and you can have dashes, but not another at sign, because then I could say at string at and so on. Instead, I could also check the log entries and say that, you know, we always write the email address and then add a comma. We could use an E string and tell it to use anything until it comes up on a comma or a bracket, because valid email address is open bracket, email address close bracket.
And that is
if there is a decimal point in it, then it, then it's number. If there is not, it's float. So there is no such decimal point in float. And we have also three IP parsers: IPv4, IPv6, and IPvNYAT. What will be the tricky parts? There are some minor things here, but we can answer them one by one. One is the contentual repetition, which I didn't like at the beginning, because I had to pattern in a postfix for myself, for my own purpose. And since I was my own customer in a hobby project, I couldn't quit. And in the case of POST, we use POSIX 2 and ORIC 2, which indicates to whom the letter was originally sent by the sender. And here we are expecting an email address, and then what we received, it is not an address. And it was my wife, actually, who sent the letter, and she put lots of fields into 2, and then I told her to use BCC, and she said that it means something else, as if it is written into 2. And then the problem is that when you expect an email address, then repetitions may occur separated by commas 5, 6, 8, but in that time a parser must be used, which is already prepared to take them apart. If you just do a simple parser for email address, then it is expecting only one. The other thing is that if there is a single event which will produce a number of commands or reports, and there is nothing, no information in the commands. These log messages very often come without any links. For example, a Windows log generates 3 to 4 log messages, and there is, as far as I could judge, there is no such data that would connect these messages. And also there are messages with missing parts.